Thank you, Mr. Duraiyaj, for giving us a warm welcome. And I must also thank you for giving us the opportunity to conduct this webinar and giving insights about energy and water conservation in industrial and commercial buildings. So I hope everybody is safe during this pandemic. And I consider attending webinar and conducting webinar surely a knowledge sharing platform. So straightly get into the presentation. So this is a presentation on energy and water conservation through IoT and industrial and commercial sectors. And this presentation is taken under the management of Thakur Engineering College, Chennai. And the presenters are myself, D. Sanjeev, and my colleague, Mr. M. Vamsikrishna. So let's see the presentation structure first to give overall overview into the webinar. First, we'll discuss about the energy scenario in India and the need for energy conservation. Which will be very interesting if you realize the potential for energy conservation. And comes the energy conservation avenues, which we are as the consultants usually propose energy save proposals to our clients. And then introduction to IoT and how IoT is a solution for energy conservation and some of our case studies. And then we end up with job opportunities for you. So let's talk about the energy scenario in India. So we have listed out the total installed capacity in India. So you can see a table where the installed capacity is broken up into sector wise, like coal, renewable, gas, diesel, hydro, and nuclear, etc. So the total installed capacity is 3.7 lakh megawatt. And when I need to explain what is megawatt, I simply can tell you an example. So consider in your home, you have 100 watts of electrical appliances. When all this 100 watt of electrical appliances run for a continuous 10 hours, then it is 1 kilowatt, which means when we usually refer to one unit of electricity, it is called 1 kilowatt, and we are talking about megawatt. So 1000 kilowatt is 1 megawatt. And you can see coal is the highest contributor in terms of installed capacity. It is around 2 lakh megawatts, and the renewable is around 87,000 megawatt, which is drastically coming into the market and is going to be our future and for the global too. So next, I have given a pie chart for better understanding of this breakup. You can see coal is the highest contributor. Almost it is 56% is giving its proportion, its contribution actually. And then as I told you, this diesel is going to be the least, and nuclear it's 7,000 megawatt. It's still the same for 2 years now. And then you can see a graph. This is a graph which is depicting the energy consumption since 1970 till 2020. So this monitoring of energy consumption is released by Carbon Brief India. In the y-axis, you can see energy consumption in terms of MTO. And in the x-axis, you can see the years mentioned. So what does it depicts? Before explaining that, I should brief you what is MTO. It's a million tons of oil equivalent. So what does tons of oil equivalent actually mean? Let me tell with you an example. So let's consider coal in this case. You have 1 kg of coal. And you know the energy content of coal. In order to find out the total energy of coal, you should multiply the quantity and the energy content of coal. So the total energy content of coal, you have it. The same you do for gas, the same you do for oil, nuclear, hydro, etc. When you sum all this energy together, you get million tons of oil equivalent. So India releases its energy consumption in reference to MTO, and some other, our nearby country also releases that report. So every country in the globe will have a common reference plane, which is called as MTO. And you can see there is a steep increase in energy consumption pattern since 1970 till 2020, which means the source of generation has increased, the end users have increased, and by the result, the energy consumption has been increased. And coming to the summary of energy scenario in India, we are the world's third largest emitter of greenhouse gases, and we have pledged 35% of reduction in carbon emissions by the year 2020. And we are soon expecting a report on this, maybe after this pandemic. You can download the report in Carbon Brief India. And then, as already known, coal is the major contributor in electricity supply. And finally, the renewable power is gradually, and actually it's not gradual, it's drastically improving. The core contributor in the upcoming years and for the next generation. So what is the need for energy conservation? So here, this graph depicts the release of carbon emissions, in particular to India. The left side, you can see the amount of carbon emission in terms of million tons sector-wise, like buildings, transport, power industry, etc. So coming to the graph, on x-axis, you have emissions of CO2 in terms of million tons of CO2. And on the x-axis, you have the years mentioned. So you just have to imagine the power industry is emitting 1,246 million tons of CO2. CO2 is just a gas. It releases from the company, it goes around the globe, it surrounds our globe, and it stays there, and it increases the globe temperature. What happens when the globe temperature increases? It's very obvious, most of the living organisms cannot survive at this temperature. Most of the micro, macro living organisms will not see any habitat at this temperature. And we expect a 4 to 12 degree Fahrenheit of temperature increase by the year 2100. So this slide summarizes that the carbon emission is more, and if your energy consumption reduces, your carbon emission reduces. So next you see the potential climatic changes impact. So I just told you when CO2 settles around the upper atmosphere of globe, it increases the globe temperature. And what will be the potential climatic changes? Let's see. The Earth has increased 0.6 degrees Celsius in the last 100 years. And some of the warning signs include heat waves, sea level rising, and sometimes the glaciers melting, coastal flooding, and Arctic and Antarctic warming. So it's a great concern, and you are going to be the responsible for whatever is happening in the globe. You are one of the reason for this climatic changes too, if you are not changing yourself. And then comes the fossil fuels reserves and the year left. Yeah, here we can see oil, natural gas, and coal. All the three are non-renewable sources. Once it is depleted, it is depleted. It is not like solar or wind, which is available all the year. Coal takes nearly thousands of years to develop on its own. Likewise, the oil and natural gas. And why anyone has to worry about this? since we are talking about carbon emission and coal is one of the most largest carbon emitter, one may think that if I am so much worried about 114 years left, then it is very happy for me because my carbon emission will come down. Then why is this very important? I can tell you the reason. Since I earlier told you that coal is 56% of the contributor in installed capacity, it indirectly means that you have only 114 years left to improve your installed capacity of around 2 lakh megawatt, which means the entire 2 lakh megawatt of coal should become obsolete and you should have a fresh another source of power generation of capacity 2 lakh megawatt. So within 114 years, you find a new technology, you improve the installed capacity. Otherwise, there will be a power shortage and economic crisis will take place as how we are facing now. This is a miniature of economic crisis we are facing. And when there is no fuel at all for us to generate energy, then it's an absolute crisis. And these figures are based on the known reserves, which means unexplored. I mean, the unexplored reserves we are not taking into account. We are taking into account only the known reserves. And this is also based on the annual production levels in 2015. So the another reason for the need for energy conservation can be told by the energy flow from user, I mean from the source till end user. So here you can see five pictures. The first picture is the fuel, which means the raw material, and then comes your industry, maybe a power plant, and the third picture depicts you the transmission and distribution lines, and the fourth picture is one of your electrical appliances in home, and the fifth picture is almost as the end user. So let's see how the energy flows. So first of all, I am giving 100 units of fuel. So this fuel is called primary energy, from where we extract energy. So that medium is called primary energy. So I give 100 units of primary energy to a power plant. And the power plant losses is 60%. I think you already, you might have aware of this. The power plant efficiency, the overall power plant efficiency is just 40%. The remaining 60% will be a loss. So you can get output of just 40 units. So that 40 units is transmitted and distributed, and you get a transmission and distribution loss of around 15%, and finally it reaches your home. Here in case we have taken incandescent lamp, and you can see the output is just 5%. And remaining 95% of energy going as input to the incandescent bulb is a loss. And finally, you get 2 units. So you spend 100 units as a raw material to get 2 units as output. And the summary would be end use. If you conserve the raw material source of 1 unit, then you conserve 50 units. Summary of need for energy conservation. As I already told, you effectively use your finite sources, which means I'm talking about this non-renewable sources such as coal, oil, and natural gas. And you reduce your greenhouse gas emissions, which I was talking about CO2, and reduce the demand for installed capacity. So if the installed capacity increases, your inefficiency increases, and which directly results higher energy consumption, and then ensure sustainability. Sustainability is nothing but if I save some energy presently, that will be used in the next generation. So that's called sustainability. And we'll see some of the energy intensive equipment in industrial and commercial sectors. So we have listed out 12 intensive equipments. You can see these equipments wherever you go, wherever industry you visit, all these 12 people will be already present in there. So first you have boilers. It is used to generate steam, and furnace to melt or preheat steam, and HVAC, which is heating, ventilation and air conditioning system, just like large scale refrigerator, you can imagine. And then motors, she is the mother of all equipments. She drives all the equipments, in fact. And then air compressors, sometimes it's used for conveying and doing some pushing and mostly it is used for conveying. And fans and blowers to supply combustion air for any combustion to take place. It's also used for conveying. And you have cooling towers. It is used to remove heat from the water. And lighting, you know that. Refrigerator we have in every home. Air conditioners, the split ACs in your home. And pumps, you can see it everywhere. The population of pump is very higher. And heat exchangers, like waste heat recovery. Energy conservation avenues. So let's see, I must go back to the slide and I just forgot to explain a few things. Here I have highlighted boilers, HVAC, air compressors, lighting, refrigerators and pumps. Let's talk about the energy conservation avenues only for these six items, which I consider the more energy consumer of these 12. So energy conservation avenues, in boilers. So you have the major seven energy conservation avenues. Let's go one by one. You have first automate this boiler blowdown. Before explaining boiler blowdown, I must define terminology here called TDS, which is total dissolved solids. To be in a simple fashion, I must say that you might have faced this problem in home, like some kind of salt contamination in your water pipelines in home. That might result in some clogging. You might have opened it and cleaned it. So they are called, these salts are called total dissolved solids. It will be dissolved in the water. So when this concentration increases, what it happens is it starts eroding the pipelines. Okay. So in the case of boiler, I will tell you the potential of eroding the pipelines. So boiler is nothing but a combustion chamber. In the chamber, you have many number of tubes through which the water passes through. And in the chamber, you just burn a fuel and the combustion take place. The combustion heat is absorbed by the pipelines and the water inside the pipeline absorbs the heat from the pipeline outer surface. So when this water concentration, when this total dissolved concentration in the water increases, it actually erodes the boiler tubes, water pipelines. So what happens is there is a huge pressure difference and the pipeline bursts, which results in boiler explosion. So what we have to do is we have to blow down this water, which means we have to drain some of the water and add some more fresh water so that the TDS level comes down. So this can be automated. Presently the plant personnel, he will open the drain valve frequently for 3 to 4 hours. Once in every 3 to 4 hours, he opens the drain valve. So instead, we can automate it and we can save some water and save some energy too. Because when the water is being drained, the water is at a temperature of around 100 degrees Celsius, which means you have spent some energy to increase the water temperature from the ambient till 100 degrees Celsius. And you have optimized steam pressure. When steam pressure is lower, your fuel consumption is lower. Other steam leakages, it is direct wastage of fuel. and reduce flue gas losses. Actually, it is very interesting. Let me explain. So in order for a fuel to burn, you just need to supply combustion air. For example, you need 10 kg of air to burn 1 kg of fuel. So if you supply 15 kg of air, what will happen? Still the combustion takes only 10 kg of air and the rest of the 5 kg, it is just wasted. This 5 kg of air will absorb all the heat from the combustion chamber and it is just exhausted through the boiler chimney. So what we should do here is we should proportionately adjust the air input into the combustion chamber with respect to the fuel input. So for example, if I am admitting 1 kg of coal, you should supply only 10 kg of air so that you reduce the flue gas losses and you have avoid radiation losses. You please insulate the uninsulated area of boilers and the effective condensate recovery. Condensate is nothing but when the steam loses its energy, it becomes water, coming back to its original state. So this condensate must be recovered from the process. What is the process? Process is nothing but a user end. For example, a user needs some heat. Then I supply the heat in terms of steam. The steam gives the heat to the process and it comes back to the boiler in water, in form of water. So we collect this water and use it in the boiler bag. This water, when condenses, it will be around 100 degrees Celsius. And if you collect it effectively, you can save some fuel instead of heating the water from ambient till 100 degrees Celsius. You can use back the condensate. And this is the reason why the TDS increases too. If we can relate it to the first point, you can remember that when the TDS increases, the erosion or the tube erosion takes place. So when you use the water repeatedly, cycle by cycle, then your TDS increases, which means the concentration of TDS increases. That results in tube erosion, and tube erosion results in a huge pressure difference between the combustion chamber and the pipeline, which results in boiler explosion. And the last will be installing air preheater and economizer in the flue gas path. So air preheater, I just said that you need combustion air for burning any fuel. So if I supply the air at 70-80 degrees Celsius rather than supplying at 30 degrees Celsius, then the fuel will burn effectively and the fuel energy you supply to, what I mean to say is the time taken to combust will come down and your energy will come down. So you preheat the air and give it to the combustion chamber. And economizer is nothing but preheating the water. So how you preheat the air and how you preheat the economizer? I don't do anything. I just install a heat exchanger in the flue gas path. I already explained what is a flue gas. It's just the exhaust of a combustion. This combustion, while leaving the boiler through chimney, I just keep a heat exchanger just for preheating the air, which is called air preheater, and one more heat exchanger, which is called economizer, to preheat the water. This water gets heat from the flue gas first, and it goes to the main combustion chamber from where it gets converted into steam. So these are the main major energy conservation avenues in boilers. Still, there are many to explore, but this is not the time. It will take 2-3 more hours of time, which will test your patience, in fact. Energy conservation avenues in air compressors. So the function of air compressor, it is just to increase the pressure of air for doing any activities like pushing and conveying anything. So here, some of the energy conservation avenues will be starting with reducing the intake air temperature. So when the intake air temperature reduces, your volume of the air reduces, and hence your power consumption will come down. and then you have arrest compressed air leakage. So compressed air leakage is a direct form of electricity, and then you have maintenance of intake air filter. So if air filter is clogged, the incoming air air pressures will drop when it bypasses, I mean when it processes through the when it process I mean when it passes through the air filter, its pressures drop actually. So in this case, the compressor has to work hard to increase the pressure, and thus resulting in high power consumption. So use air amplifiers for cleaning. Air amplifiers, what they does is, so if you need 10 units of air for cleaning, this air amplifier will take only 6 units of air, and the rest of the 4 units will be the ambient air. These both air will be mixed together and will be used for cleaning. So you can, I mean, the air consumption quantity will reduce. So the air generation will reduce, and hence the power consumption will reduce. And you have avoid pressure drop in distribution lines. So if the distribution lines have many bends and many length, many increasing length of distribution line, a large pressure drop will be there. And in order to compensate that pressure drop, you just have to increase the generating pressure of the compressor. And when you increase the generating pressure of the compressor, your power consumption will increase. So design, a proper design of distribution line is required. And then you have operate only at required pressure. If your requirement is just 4 bar, then why you need to operate compressor at 5 bar? And at last you have segregate high pressure and low pressure requirements. So in this case, you find, I mean, you list out the high pressure and low pressure requirements. You dedicate a separate compressor for high pressure and low pressure requirements, rather than operating a single compressor at high pressure and supplying at low pressure requirements by using some pressure reduction valve. And it is again a form of electricity wastage. Then you have energy conservation opportunities in pumps. Avoid valve usage and throttling. Throttling is nothing but reducing the head and reducing the flow. So pump actually increases the head, which means increases the pressure of water. In case of air compressor, the pressure of air is increased. So in that case, when you throttle the outlet of the pump, it's again a form of electricity wastage. Why you need to increase the pressure by the pump and you have to decrease the pressure by throttling? So you just need to understand the requirement and design a pump, which means select a proper design, which means instead of delivering 100 meter cube of water, you should not select 200 meter cube per hour of delivery. So select a proper design for pump and deploy in your process area. And then the speed reduction. So here I should tell you that when speed reduces, your flow reduces. And I mean, I think your flow should be reduced when your requirement is coming down. At that time, it is valid. When your speed is reduced, your electricity consumption will reduce. And then you have impeller trimming. Impeller trimming is nothing but you decrease the diameter of the impeller. When the impeller diameter is decreased, the flow reduces and the electricity consumption also reduces. Again, if the flow reduces, if it is not affecting your process, if it is not affecting your requirement, then you reduce the flow. Again, it's coming to water restriction. I mean, yeah, I'm talking about this leakage restriction, arrest it, and then proper pipe sizing. Again, if you didn't go for a proper diameter and proper length and proper ducting, you have a large pressure drop across the distribution, and that demands the pump to increase the pressure of the water more. That results in higher power consumption. And at last, you have installed VFD wherever necessary. VFD is nothing but variable frequency drive. What it does is, when you want to reduce the speed, it reduces. how it reduces. When your requirement, for example, you need 50 units of water at one point of time, and after 1 hour you may need only 20 units of water. So when the speed reduces, as I told you earlier, when the speed reduces, your flow reduces. This VFD gives a feedback on your requirement that we require only 20 units of water instead of 50, and then this VFD reduces the speed of the pump, and hence the flow reduces, and thus results in lower electricity consumption. And then you have energy conservation opportunities in HVAC, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. So maintain set point temperature. To be to explain in a simple fashion, in your home you are setting the temperature at 18 degrees Celsius. Even sometimes in my childhood I set at 20 degree and 21 degrees Celsius. So set at the optimum level. For us, if the outside temperature is 28 degrees Celsius, your room temperature at 24 degrees Celsius will be very comfortable. So maintain the set point only at the desired level. Then comes your operator laser approach. Laser approach, this is applicable to massive level of refrigeration. In home, we have just one tier and 1.5 tier. Maximum 2 tier you can have in your home. And more than 2 tier, it is not required for your home at any point of time. But when you go for some commercial buildings, you can see up to 700 tiers. So in that cases, maintaining the approach at lesser level will give you a huge electricity reduction. So what's an approach? To explain at layman terms, I can tell you that it is a difference in temperature between your refrigerant and your chilled water temperature. So if this difference is maintained at a very lesser point, then your approach will be good, which results in lesser power consumption of the chiller unit. I mean, if you are talking in small in terms of refrigeration, you say AC, and if you talk about large in terms of refrigeration, you call it as chiller. For example, 700 TR, you can call it as chiller. Install, efficient air handling systems. So air handling system is nothing but, how we can say this, you just imagine like an empty space with a proper ceiling with cardboard. So in this empty space, I have a tube, water tubes. In that, chilled water at 7 to 8 degrees Celsius will be continuously circulating on. So what I do is I suck the air from room, and I blow the air on this chilled water tubes in the air handling unit. So this air absorbs chillness from the cold water tube, and the chilled air comes back to the room again. The chilled air absorbs heat from our body, and then it goes back to the air handling system. So this cycle will be repeatedly going on. You just have to imagine a 700 TR property, which means imagine like 100 homes in a single, multi-story building. You can have 100 split ACs in that multi-story building, but your energy consumption will be very high. So in order to deal with this, we have chiller unit, which means at a single point of time, I generate chilled water at 7 degrees Celsius, and I supply this water to every room. Every 100 room, I supply this water, and I purportedly make air to blow over these chilled water tubes, and the air gets chilled, and you get the chilled air into the room. So then comes the installed energy efficient pumps. So normally the efficiency of the pump will be around 70%. So the efficiency of the pump will be around 70%, and you must need to determine the efficiency of the pump then and then. If it is performing at 40% or 30, 20, etc., you better replace the pump. And before replacing the pump, you just find out the payback period. If it is highly supporting you, you don't give it a second thought, you just replace the pump. Then comes the cooling tower operation. So this cooling tower removes heat from the water. Let's not go much detail into this. A separate session is required for cooling tower because it has a huge scope for energy conservation. Reduce heat ingress. Find different ways to reduce the heat ingress in your building. The existing building we cannot do, but the upcoming buildings we can do by incorporating several tubes in the concrete while building the home itself. So the water will be circulating in the tubes. It will be absorbing the heat from the room, and it goes back to the roof and releases the heat to the atmosphere. This is a new kind of technology which is emerging in the market, and it's going to be our future too. So I'm just telling a simple example for a heat ingress. And when you start, innovating many ideas for energy conservation avenues, you get different for this heat ingress avoiding. And you have a preferred flow control valves for efficient chilled water distribution. So flow control valves, as I said earlier, you might be having many air handling units. Refer to the point number three. You might be having many air handling systems. Say, for example, for 100 rooms, I have 100 air handling units. 50% of the rooms will not be occupied, but still the chilled water will be circulating in the rest of the 50 unoccupied rooms, which is a wastage of energy. Circulation losses will be there, and pumping loss will be there. So you use some flow control valve, and this flow control valve will operate only when there is an occupancy in that particular room. And let's come to the energy saving opportunities in home appliances. It will be very useful for you. Coming to lighting, it is purchased star rated products. Bureau of Energy Efficiency, Ministry of Power, they actually give a star rating to every product it actually supplies. So you might have seen that in fridge, you can see have a 3-star and 4-star rating. So that rating is given by Bureau of Energy Efficiency, Government of India. So if you have a 3-star product, it means that your electricity consumption will be higher, and if it is 5-star, your electricity consumption will be lower for delivering 1 unit of product output. And comes turn off lights when not in use. This everybody knows it, but it is one of the simplest way of energy conservation. And then comes your replace incandescent bulb and fluorescent tube lamps with LED lamps. During 1990s, many of them were using incandescent bulb, and most of them were ignorant to change their practice of using fluorescent tube lamps. And again, nowadays, many of the people are preferring LED lamps. So this is the evolution of technology. First, we were using incandescent lamp, and we found energy efficient product called FTL lamp. And then we found a more productive one, which is called LED lamps. Always prefer LED lamps. Use sunlight to avoid light usage and dating. So use the sunlight. Maybe a light pipe equipment can be used to deliver the sunlight into the home. And you use occupancy sensor. The lighting will automatically get on and off using the occupancy sensor, which is not applicable to home, but for commercial buildings, it will be very useful. And for AC, again, it is purchasing star rated air conditioners. And then the set point temperature I was talking about in energy saving avenues in HVAC, set the desired temperature only. And then the third point is very interesting. You just keep your fan at speed number one, and keep your AC set temperature at 26 degrees Celsius. You will feel very comfortable. You will not be needing a blanket. you just feel very comfortable. Try one more, try at your home. It will be one of the easiest way of energy conservation. And then comes leave enough space between air conditioner and the walls to allow better air circulation. See, the AC removes heat from the room. Some way it has to be exhausted to the atmosphere. So for exhausting it to the atmosphere, it should be heavily exposed to the atmosphere. Then the heat rejection will be more efficient. If it is placed in a congested place, then your heat rejection will not take place efficiently, and you will not get good chillness in your room, and you will not achieve your set temperature too. So leave enough space between air conditioner and the walls, and a roof garden can reduce load on air conditioner. And coming to refrigerator, it is about naturally cooling the food before placing the inside the refrigerator. The leftover food will be still hot. You don't straightly keep it in the fridge. Instead, you keep it in your dining table for some time, and then you keep it inside the refrigerator. And again, you give some space between the walls and the heat rejection area so that the performance of refrigerator will increase. And then you have make sure refrigerator door seals are airtight. So if the door seals are not airtight, there due to this temperature, virtue of temperature difference, chilled air in the refrigerator will come to our room, so that the refrigerator had to work hard to maintain that food temperature at cold. Then you have cover liquids and wrap foods stored in the refrigerator. This is nothing but every food content will have moisture content. So when you keep it in the fridge, this food will eventually release the moisture content. And in order to remove the moisture content, the refrigerator has to work harder. So your electricity consumption will be very high. Better you wrap it or you just enclose it in a vessel. That will be more recommendable solution for this. And again, you purchase a star rated refrigerator. And the energy conservation avenues for the highlighted ones, we have completed it. And then comes the typical constraints expected by industrial and commercial sectors. So first, I have explained the scenario of energy and the need for energy conservation. And I have given you the list of energy intensive equipments. And I have presented you the energy saving conservation in all those equipments. And finally, the typical constraints expected by industrial and commercial sectors when he is thinking about energy conservation. So what they are, let's go one by one. So the first will be lack of knowledge on energy conservation. So yes, I think it's not necessary for explaining. And then comes the cost of energy is insignificant for some end users. Some end user, which means the plant head, may think that he has some other bigger work than this, and he may think that what this one unit of saving will give me monetary saving, just leave it and go for other priority work. So he may think like that. He may think that this cost of energy spending will be insignificant. So make him realize energy is significant, and give him an energy audit and make him understand the potential of energy saving. Then you have lack of knowledge on utilization quantum. It is nothing but if you don't know the quantity of your electricity usage, you will not do any step for energy conservation. For example, in your home, if you consume 8,000 units, and you pay 16,000 rupees as your electricity bill, then you start thinking about it. Why I have spent 16,000 for electricity bill? why it should not reduce my electricity bill. So that is why I'm telling you, just quantify it. The quantum of the electricity usage must be understood. Then you have lack of knowledge on savings potential. We should quantify the savings. To be very simple, I can tell that replacing an incandescent lamp with LED lamp will give you just 2-3 watts of savings. But when you consider for 2 to 3 years, it will be huge lot of savings. So you should understand the potential coming out of it, and then you will definitely take a step on implementing the same. And then comes your restriction on budgetary and capital investment. Maybe the company's budget will be very tight and they will be having some other commitments too. And then you have non-availing the services of good energy consultants. I mean, the proximity of the company may not have some good energy consultant. So we should find good energy auditors and make them come to your place to conduct an energy audit, and you just get some insights for energy conservation revenues. And then you have a lack of initiatives from top management. The top management will not be very interesting to take up this energy conservation avenues. We as consultants, we are facing this often. So the make first of all, the plant head has to realize the potential of energy saving, and then only he can convince the management. So far we have covered the energy conservation, and now we are into water conservation. So just imagine, for 150 gram of pizza, you need 1000 liters of water. And for 1 kg rice, cooking for 1 kg rice, you need 2400 liters of water. And for 1 cotton shirt manufacturing, you need 2600 liters of water. And for manufacturing 1 jean, you need 7000 liters of water. And for 1 kg of chocolate, you need 70000 liters of water. And for 1 ton of steel, you need like 2 lakh liters of water. Just imagine how much water we are consuming. We are not conscious about it. Without our conscience, we are using hell amount of water. To your surprise, your water necessity will be just 1% against your 100% of actual consumption. Why it is necessary is because you have only 3% left over for drinking water. So that is why water conservation is very necessary. And let's see some of the water conservation avenues. Use dual flush valves, which means based on your nature of call, you just prefer whatever flush it may require. This dual flush valve will have one will have high water flow rate, the other one will have low water flow rate. And use the appropriate flush based on your requirement. And then comes the restrictive aerators. Aerators just restricts the flow of water, and at the same time, it will not compromise the water you need. And then comes the water treatment system. You can treat the water and use it again. Use treated water for flushing. For flushing purpose, we can use the treated water system. This will be very helpful in commercial buildings. And then comes the avoid water leakage. It's known to everyone. And then you have established water benchmark. So what is water benchmark? I can tell you that what is the output for one unit of input. For example, liter of water used to deliver one unit of output. So this is called water benchmark. In commercial buildings, we can tell liters of water per meter square of area. So this is called water benchmark. And if this benchmark is monitored on a continuous basis, And if you found out that this value is deviating in huge in nature, then you start something is wrong and you start exploring the possible, I mean, failures for it, and you start rectifying it. And then you have replace high water flow closets and flush valves, many other efficient, low flow rate closets are available according to your IPC standards. IPC is nothing but Indian Plumbing Code standards. And then you have typical constraints expected from water conservation. So what are the constraints you have? You don't know how much water you are consuming, and you don't know what's the pressure of the water which is being circulated. You don't know where the water is leaking. You don't know what is the quality of the water, and you don't know what is the efficiency of the treatment plant. So all this can be managed with an integrated solution, which I'm going to come up next, which is called Internet of Things. So then if you can't measure it, you can't control it. Quantify the monetary loss and effects, quantify the excess raw material consumption, quantify redundant electricity consumption. If you quantify it, you really start taking measures to reduce your energy consumption. So need for integrated solution. So what's the need for integrated solution? So we are humans. It's a normal tendency to commit mistakes. And how we can reduce the frequency of occurring mistakes. So, and at the same time, the purpose of such equipment should also be should not be compromised. So we need an integrated solution in which the manual intervention is reduced. And you can see here a doll is thinking about why it is happening and what to do, how we will manage this. He's thinking about it a lot for a time. And you should reduce the manual intervention to facilitate demand-based operation. Operate based only on your requirement, and automate the process to improve your system efficiency, to ensure personal safety too. And you locate the source of the problem, and to mitigate the misuse of energy users, generate alerts on system deviation, auto generation of reports. So whatever we are seeing in every boxes, these are our requirements for any operation. All these points should not be compromised. All these points should be happened at right point of time at maximum efficiency. So we need 80% of automation and 20% of manual intervention, just for number sake I'm telling. So how it can be accomplished, the integrated solution? So the integrated solution is called the Internet of Things. So the Internet of Things, it interconnects people, devices, data, and several processes, so that at last you get energy conservation. So first of all, the first category of IoT is IoT smart devices and sensors. So like temperature sensors, pressure sensors, oxygen sensors, etc. So what they do is they collect the data. Say for example, it measures the temperature, and it communicates via Bluetooth or Wi-Fi, and other communication protocols are there, like Zigbee technology, etc. It based on the range of the signal available. You know, Wi-Fi you can go up to 10 meters, and Bluetooth you can have up to 5 meters. Based on your operating range, you can change your communication protocol. What it does is the sensors collect the actual operating parameters. It communicates these data to your cloud or your local PC through a communication protocol called Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. So in data storage in your PC, what happens is the data is, the entire data is completely stored, and it has some artificial intelligence through which we emerge some formulas, and these automatically some calculations will take place, so to give you the operating efficiency of the system. So finally, if the operating efficiency is found out, and the IoT is very concerned about the lesser efficiency, what it does is it induces feedback to IoT devices. So to adjust it, for example, actuator will be one of your IoT smart device. So this actuator, what it does is, if the water flow is very high, your artificial intelligence give the signals to the actuator, and this actuator will adjust the water flow. So instead of a person going there to the place and adjusting the valve, we can have this IoT with artificial intelligence and operate the actuator on remote basis and achieve energy savings. This is to be made simple. I have explained this with some circles and with devices and sensors, communication protocols, etc. And the user too. So this augmented intelligence can be just induced by user also. So when this data is coming to your mobile, you just can click it, like open the actuator or adjust the actuator by simply pressing a button. This signal will go to the actuator in place, and the actuator will start its function. So again, how IoT made simple? You have wired overdoing, overcooling, whatever overdoing is taking place in the processes. It actually controls it and gives you the energy conservation. And how IoT is a solution to energy conservation? So let's see with some examples. This is one of our case study in one commercial building. So you have energy, electrical, you have energy, which means the total energy consumption of the facility, the electrical consumption of the facility, diesel generator units, lighting, chiller units, as I mentioned earlier, AHU, boiler, heat pump. Heat pump is for hot water generation instead of using a geyser. And then you have cold rooms, kitchen, laundry. I'm talking about industrial laundries, guest rooms, and then the banquet halls. Then you have locker rooms and WTP, STP, and water, etc. So all these areas, the actual energy consumption can be first monitored. And then the suitable necessary feedback can be given to achieve the necessary energy savings. So all this data is transferred through IoT gateway, and it goes to the cloud. From the cloud, it comes to your laptop with some inbuilt dashboard system. And then the command center, you can operate it. You can give some command so that it again goes back from to the cloud, and then to the IoT gateway, and then to the sensors. So two-way communication is there, and you operate remotely, and you reduce the manual intervention, and you increase the energy efficiency. And you have a boiler. A real-time example has been taken how IoT can be deployed in boilers. So you install steam flow meters, get the actual steam generation. Then you have water flow meters, field water flow, you quantify it. Then how much is the fuel consumption? Then you have energy meters and O2 sensor. As I told you earlier, if the combustion air is too much high, then it leads to more flue gas loss. So this O2 sensor collects the oxygen level, and if the oxygen level is higher, it gives alerts in the command center, and I again give some feedback, myself, then again a signal goes to the oxygen sensor. It just gives some adjustments in the air input system, and the combustion air entry is controlled, and hence the efficiency of the boiler increase. So this is one real-time example we have found out in one of the hotels in India. What it does is it continuously monitors the energy consumption, and it also benchmarks. Then it also observes the user behavior. It gives instantaneous boiler efficiency throughout the day. And comes the HVAC. So again, the water flow meter, energy meters, and pressure sensor, temperature sensors, cooling towers. When I'm talking about cooling towers, a single chiller plant will have 2-3 cooling towers, but the actual requirement will be 2 cooling towers, but the personnel may not be aware of it. He might be running 3 cooling towers at a single point of time. So IoT recognizes this, it actually recognizes the requirement, and it gives a signal to the cooling tower. The signal induces one of the cooling tower to switch off, and then your energy savings. So again, the same thing, it continuously monitors, it sets some benchmark value, and it also does scheduling operation, which means if I schedule some operation, like I need the chiller only to operate at 7 to 8 a.m. then I can schedule it instead of manually going there and switching off the chiller. So it automatically schedules it, and then your performance of the chillers will be monitored online as well as remotely. And then the dynamic set point, this is nothing but instead you just compare it with your home. You just change your temperature by taking the remote. And in this case, with help of IoT, it does not require a remote. The IoT senses the ambient temperature, and it senses the room temperature, and accordingly, based on your comfortability, it changes the set point of your AC or refrigeration system. So IoT does this. And then comes your air compressors. So you have energy meters and air flow meters to just quantify it, and then you can control it. Then your coolant temperature. To say this is the 100, when you supply 100 units of input to air compressor, the output will be only 10%. So the remaining 90% of input will be gone as a heat, will be exhausted as a heat. So we should quantify how much air the compressor is generating. For example, if the compressor is designed for giving an output of 500 units, and at the real time, if the compressor is just generating 250 units of air, this can be easily determined from the airflow meters. And through IoT, you can monitor it remotely. And if this generation keeps on varying, you just ask your personnel to take the necessary steps, etc. Then you have a filter monitoring, like pressure monitoring. At the inlet of the filter, you have one pressure sensor, and at the outlet of the filter, you have one more pressure sensor. So these two sensors gives you a differential pressure, and if the differential pressure is very large, it means that your filter is clogged and it's time to change the filter or clean the filter. In that way, your electricity consumption of compressor has been reduced. Then again, you can monitor the inlet air temperature too. So all this data is given to IoT, collected by IoT. And again, this data will be used for benchmarking and analytics, and monitor the operational practices. Yes, and then comes the water. So far we have seen IoT in energy conservation. Now it's for water conservation. So let's see how IoT will benefit in water management. First of all, it monitors the pressure to determine if there is any pressure drop. It is mainly because of the leakage, and it is because secondarily it is because of your design. If the pressure reduces, you can feel that something wrong is there, which means the leakage is there, and you try to arrest it. And then pump on and off control by water tank level monitoring. So to explain in simple terms, Let me give you an example which is often taking place at our home. In fact, in our home, when our tank, water tank gets filled, the water starts overflowing. So this overflowing is the signal for us to switch off the pump. So during this course of overflowing, you just incur a lot of water wastage. So for example, if there is one overflow per day, and if you consider 365 days, and if you consider a period of 10 years, a hell load of water will be wasted by you. Instead, if this water is being conserved, you can use it for the next generation, which is and to ensure sustainability. And then comes your water quality testing. Again, it is about TDS. You have water consumption monitoring, how much water you are using. And then you have tanker water management. So this is applicable to commercial buildings. So how much water you are getting from borewell, how much water you are getting from tanker. So IoT closely monitors this. And at the end of the month, it gives you a report that this much of water is purchased from the government, this much of the water is sucked from the borewells. So all these reports will be automatically generated by IoT. And then this ultimately reduces your billing and reduces leakage, as I told you earlier. And you can have 10% reduction in water consumption too. So then IoT is friend to engineering. Yeah, it is a friend to engineering by reducing the manual intervention, doing some automation, improving the operating efficiency of the system. Through these points, I must say that IoT is a friend to engineering. And the second will be simply stated typical pain points. Every commercial buildings or every industry you take, they will be having some pain points. These pain points are very normal. The plant head itself, he knows the pain points, but he may not have any idea how to control it. So IoT helps to control it. First find it out and then control it. IoT shows the way. It gives you the solution. And then IoT is for better profits and not the expense of service, safety, quality, comfort, aesthetics, everything. It will not compromise all these six, seven points. It will not compromise at any point. And at the same time, it is providing your requirement too. So IoT solution, a 360 degree approach. It is just like a summary. You collect the data, you do data analytics, which means doing some calculations like finding out the boiler efficiency or finding out the O2 level in the flue gas. If the O2 level is high, then some actuator will start working on, which is called as the implementation phase. And then the measurement and verification. IoT also gives you a report that you have reduced the oxygen level from X to Y. So in this reduction, you are saving this much of fuel and thereby this much of cost and energy. It gives that report too. And then comes your sustain the savings. Sustain the savings, it means it maintains it. The operation is maintained. The signal passing and receiving is sustaining so that the operation is sustaining at highest optimum level. So some of our case studies in industrial and commercial buildings. We have DG monitoring and boilers, elevators, fire pump, locker room. Every part of the building is being monitorized, and it is communicated through internet to a PC, and all necessary actions are taken. And then some of the case studies like two buildings and one industry. You can have 5.6 maximum of 6% savings and a minimum of 3% savings. And these savings are very negligible, but IoT can give a maximum savings of up to 25%. It is possible. And the three clients are belonging to the two buildings and industry. They have much, they don't have much investment, and that is why the percentage is stopped at 5.6, which means a maximum of 6%. And you and finally the job opportunities for the emerging students. See, first you get a degree on mechanical engineering, and then you go for higher studies. Study masters in energy engineering. So this energy conservation is going to be the next era. So at one point of time, every student started studying mechanical engineering, and mechanical engineering became dull, and many of them jumped to do CS, and from there they jumped to do ECE, and finally they jumped to do some like non-engineering courses also. When there is a steep decrease, definitely there will be a steep increase. So wait for the time, you don't get yourself going into such uncomfortable situation. You just study it, you pursue it, you just have any degree in energy or some courses related to energy, become energy auditor after 2-3 years of experience, and be an energy consultant, because energy conservation is going to be your next era. So you have opportunities in teaching, marketing, and accounts as well. So UVK's credentials, we have experience of over 3 decades in many industries and commercial buildings, and we are expanding our services in overseas also, in Middle East and in United States. So we actually conducted energy audit at over 500 luxury hotels for energy and water efficiency, and giving them IoT solutions too. And some of our clients are Caterpillar, ITC, Taj, Oberoi, Toyota, United Breweries, etc. And the recap. So I must end the presentation with the recap. So we have just seen the energy scenario, what is the present level of consumption, and what are the energy consuming equipments, major energy consuming equipments. And we have seen the introduction to IoT and how IoT will be helpful in energy consumption. And finally, we have given some opportunities for young professionals for you. So I must say all the best for the upcoming energy engineers. And I also thank Tagore Engineering College for giving us an opportunity to conduct a webinar. And it is, we are very happy that we are giving insights about energy and water conservation, and as well as our company, so that a joint merger will help every students to grow. You can do internship in our company. If you perform well, you can get into the energy field without having a master's degree. So try to do your best. All the best. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So we have, this is the mail ID. We will circulate the presentation to everyone. For any queries, you just contact the above mentioned mail IDs. Thank you.